Writing the equation of a rotated conic in standard form, step 1. Use the equation cotangent of 2 theta is equal to a minus c over b, those coefficients of our first three terms in the general form, to find the angle the x and y axis need to be rotated to make them parallel to the axis of the conic section. So we're rotating sort of like we're making a new x and y axis, really, a transformed x and y axis, to make it possible to simplify, to simplify the equation of this conic into sort of the more general recognizable standard forms, and again, allow us to graph it more easily. So we're rotating the axis to transform the equation to simplify its appearance and make it easier to graph. And I'll make sure that when we finish both examples, but when we finish the first example, I'll make sure to point out the original x and y axis and then how they've been rotated on the same graph. Substitute that theta into the rotation formulas. X is equal to x prime cosine of theta minus y prime sine of theta. And that x little prime notation, if you will, and the y prime is saying, hey, these aren't really the original x and y axis. It's not the original equation. It's sort of this new translated, transformed system to make the graphing process simpler. And then y is equal to x prime sine of x plus y prime cosine of, that should not be an x. That should be a theta like everything else. Hello? Well, I thought that take went well enough. Let's just change that. And plus y prime cosine of theta and simplify. Now, this idea of theta, if the cotangent of 2 theta, this expression of a minus c over b, if that comes out to be positive, we're going to select theta so that theta is between 0 and 45 degrees. And if the cotangent of 2 theta is negative, then we're going to select theta so that the theta is between 45 and 90 degrees. What the heck are they talking about? And you probably wouldn't even think about this if this ratio comes out to be positive. But let's not forget the ratio of, you know, what do you put into a trig function? You put into an angle measure, and when you get out, or basically the sides of a triangle, and the ratio for the cotangent of theta, you know, if you're talking about angles in standard form, you're going to say it's x over y. If you're talking about just, you know, regular right triangle trig, you'll say x adjacent over opposite. But if you think of the cotangent as x over y, the angles in standard position, the cotangent can be positive in two quadrants. Cotangent can be positive in quadrant 1 and quadrant 3, because in those quadrants, either both the x and y are positive or both the x and y are negative, thus giving you a positive ratio. Well, I want to make sure that, you know, I make this rotation as small as possible just for convenience. And I want that to be in quadrant 1. I don't want theta to be anything bigger than, you know, an acute angle. Did I write that anywhere? I didn't really write that anywhere. I wanted to say that, you know, theta needs to be an acute angle. But why is it saying that theta needs to be between 0 and 45? Well, you're going to be solving for a 2 theta, a double angle. So our last step is going to be to divide by 2. And if you have an angle, of course, between 0 and 90, and then you divide it by 2, you have an angle between, you know, 0 and 45 degrees. And then if this ratio comes out to be negative, well, cotangent being x over y, it can be negative in quadrant 2 and quadrant 4. Well, again, I want to draw the diagram so that 2 theta is set up in quadrant 2, so that when I divide all of those values, if I take 180 and 90 and I divide those by 2, I get angles that are between what? Between 45 and 90 degrees, at least if you're doing the work in degrees. You might be doing it in radians. So make sure that you pay attention to the quadrants where you're drawing your reference triangle if you need to. In the second example, we will need to. We're going to get an angle that's not on the unit circle. And draw it so that the single angle is an acute angle, thus, you know, basically in quadrant 1. Substitute these expressions into the original equation and simplify. If you still have an xy term after doing this transformation, you have made a mistake, whether it was finding the angle theta, or more than likely, because the amount of work that is involved in these problems, it's going to probably be an annoying little algebraic example, or not example, but mistake you made through the long process that that these problems are going to be, and that can unfortunately make finding your mistake a little bit difficult. So you should have the xy term gone, And then once you remove that XY term with this transformation, you're going to continue simplifying or working with this transformed equation until you get it into standard form, like we've been doing already, where we were graphing our ellipses and hyperbolas and conic sections, where I can see the equation, I can look at the equation and see what the center is. I can identify A and B and thus know how far to move, you know, in some direction away from the center of our conic section to get a sketch of it. And that is about it. We are ready to get to our first example right now. First example, we're going to, well, I guess technically the third example, right? We're going to write the appropriate rotation formula so that in a rotated system, the XY term does not exist in our first example. We're going to use these formulas to rewrite the conic section in a rotated X prime, Y prime system, where we're going to take those X and Y axis and sort of rotate them and make a new pair or a new set of them. And then we're going to write that transformed equation into standard form and graph it without the aid of a calculator. And then we'll finish with a calculator. So, first of all, and for some of this, we're going to have to erase all this and kind of show this middle step here, part B, is going to be where all the algebra comes in, and we'll need to clear off the board to get room for all of that. We're going to find out the angle of which we need to rotate this X and Y axis and make a new set, basically. So we're going to take the cotangent of 2 theta is equal to A, which is going to be 8. Actually, let's go ahead and do this so I don't run out of room. A, which is 8, minus C, which is going to be 3. And then that is going to be over b, which is 5 square root of 3. Okay, now simplifying this, we have, of course, 8 minus 3 is equal to 5. That is over 5 square root of 3. If we cancel those 5s out, we get 1 over the square root of 3. And if we rationalize the numerator and denominator, if I multiply both the numerator and denominator by the square root of 3, we're going to get that the cotangent of 2 theta is equal to the square root of 3 over 3. Now we're going to get the cotangent function away from the 2 theta by applying the inverse cotangent function. So now we have 2 theta is equal to the inverse cotangent, or arc cotan, of square root of 3 over 3. Now here's where you need to be able to look at that square root of 3 over 3 and recognize that ratio from the unit circle. So this particular example, we don't need a calculator at all to complete the problem. Well, I made this example up, so I didn't use one of the ones in the book. So the numbers might get a little ugly here and there, but basically not need a calculator. So what angle measure? This is an inverse trig function, right? So we're putting the sides of an angle in, basically the ratio of x over y, and we need an angle measure. So what angle measure is going to, let's see here, cotangent is x over y. So we got, hopefully just know the unit circle, but if you don't, the x coordinate is square root of 3. Our y coordinate is 3. Pythagorean theorem would be that this is the square root of 3 squared plus square root of 3 squared. So now we're looking at the square root, that's 9, and that's 3. So 9 plus 3 is 12, and that is going to be 2 times the square root of 3, because 12 is, 4 times 3, and 4 is a perfect square. So let's see here. We've got the hypotenuse is twice the length of this leg of square root of 3, and when we have that 1 to 2 to, it doesn't look like square root of 3, but we do have that pattern of 1 to 2 to square root of 3 pattern, that ratio, then the side opposite the square root of 3 is going to be 30 degrees, and the side opposite the medium size side is going to be 60 degrees, again, if you're working with degrees. So the 2 theta is going to be 60 degrees, and dividing both sides by 2, of course, we get theta is equal to 30 degrees. Okay, so now that we know what angle we need to rotate the x and y axis, to make them parallel to the axis that is in that are in this conic section. Let's get our transformation formula set up, and we have x is equal to x prime cosine of 30 degrees minus y prime times the sine of 30 degrees, and likewise down here as well. Now, the cosine of 30 degrees is on your unit circle square root of 3 over 2. So we've got x is equal to, let's put it over here, I think I can squeeze this in, the square root of 3 over 2, x prime, minus sine of 30 degrees is 1 half, y prime, and down here we're going to have the sine of 30 again is 1 half, so we have 1 half x prime, plus the cosine of 30, square root of 3 over 2, y prime. Now what we're going to do is we're going to clear off this board because I'm already starting to run out of room, and we're going to get into the lengthy step of this process, which is use these formulas to rewrite the conic section in a rotated x prime, y prime system. And remember, when we're done with that, we should no longer have an xy term. So I'm going to erase all of this. I'm going to move this equation up in the corner. I'm going to do the substitution with these transformation equations. And I don't want to do this much work and talk and think and write at the same time. I'm likely to make a small error somewhere, and I want to make sure that I catch it if I do. So I'm going to show this, and I'm going to reveal the process one step at a time, and then come in and talk over any kind of issues that I think you might have working through all of that algebra before we get the graph done. So clearly there is quite a bit of algebra in these problems, and you saw that I took out the x and replaced it with the square root of 3 over 2 x prime minus 1 half y prime, and same with the y, took the y's out and replaced it with 1 half x prime plus square root of 3 over 2 y prime, and everywhere there was a y. Now, I need to keep those y prime notations in there because you can see now, you know, we have an xy axis, which is of course a horizontal and vertical axis, but we've rotated to make a new transformed or rotated x and y axis that will allow us to, you know, write what, you know, I don't know if this is an ellipse, hyperbola, parabola, whatever, but as we've expanded and combined like terms and distributed our way through all of this algebra, we now have, you know, two squared terms. We've got this conic section equal to 1, of course, so it's in standard form, and I can see with two squared terms and with these denominators being different values, or here we have two squared terms and both of our coefficients are positive and different values, that we have an ellipse. Let's see here. I did clean up my algebra a little bit as I walked through here to make sure that it all fit. Make sure that you do write this binomial twice and you do the whole expansion very carefully, because the square root of 3 times the square root of 3 is 3, and 2 times 2 is equal to 2. You do correctly create that middle term, which came from the square root of 3 times negative 1, 2 times 2. So we had a negative 3 over 4, and another negative 3 over 4, which combined to be negative 2 square root of 3 over 4, x prime, y prime. Let's see here. You know, I don't know. I'm not going to talk through all of this, I guess, but the square root of 3 over 2 times 1 half is the square root of 3 over 4. We had the square root of 3 over 2 times the square root of 3 over 2 gave us as you saw, 3 over 4, and then we had negative 1 half times positive 1 half, which gave us that negative 1 fourth, and the 3 fourths and the negative 1 fourths came together to be equal to 2 over 4. And I didn't reduce that down to 1 half because I have so many other denominators which involve the value of 4. So I didn't want to reduce that fraction because, you know, I already have a lot of common denominators. Why not just leave that in there? And after we got done applying all those powers of 2 and multiplying, we distributed the 3 and the 5 squared of 3 and the 8. You saw that I changed, hopefully that you noticed, that I wrote this x prime y prime term so that it would have a common denominator to go along with this 10 squared of 3 over 4 x prime y prime and 6 squared of 3 over 4 x prime y prime. So those x prime y prime terms canceled out. And once I saw that happen, we can still make mistakes, of course, but that xy term was gone. So I feel pretty confident of where the algebra was going. We have all of these denominators of 4, so I'm just multiplying the entire equation by 4 to eliminate those denominators, combining like terms and such, and getting our ellipse in standard form. Now that we have what is a more familiar standard form of an ellipse, hopefully we can remember that the greatest denominator is going to be a squared, and the lower denominator is going to be, denominator is going to be b squared. So a squared is equal to 20. Square root at, we have the square root of 20 is, of course, the 4 times 5. 4 is a perfect square, so we have 2 square root of 5, which is fantastic if you need your answers all in exact form. But if you're going to sketch the curve, it would be nice so that you had a decimal that you knew. It would be a little bit easier to graph that. So the square root of 20 is approximately 4.47, and the square root of 0.95 is equal to 0.975. Oh, and where did that 0.95 come from? Well, when writing all your conic sections, of course, in standard form, we need these coefficients of the x and y, or the squared terms, to be 1. So we take that 42 over 40, flip it down, if you will, and make it 1 over 40 over 2, and 40 over 2 comes out to be 0.95. Now, this, you know, I know how to draw. Now that we have something more simplified standard form of this rotated conic, that approximate value of 4.7 came from underneath the value of y, so that's a vertical movement, or now I guess a bit of an oblique movement. We are going to go along that y prime value from the center, which is 0, 0. We don't have any binomials being squared here. So from the center, which has not been changed, of 0, 0, we're going to move along the y axis. That 4.47, so approximately, what color do I want to use? I guess I'll just use purple. Sorry about the static. Let's try moving that over a little bit. So 1, 2, 3, 4.5. So there's approximately our 4.47. And of course, in the other direction as well, 1, 2, 3, 4.5. Our value of b is coming from underneath the x. We're going to move along the x-axis. In the direction of the x-axis from the center, just basically about 1. And of course, this is a chalkboard, so I'm just going to make it look like it's 1. And our conic section, our ellipse, is going to look something like this. Try and make this reasonably accurate. Not too sloppy. Best I can. I'm not sure if I'm doing a great job here. Okay, so I have graphed a sketch of the ellipse, which has been rotated 30 degrees. Now,